Welcome to today's episode of the Homes and Construction Show. In our previous episode, we looked at how renting is a prison to you, the tenant. But then we need to know how you can get out of this prison. You can do it because it starts with you. Today we are privileged because we still have Engineer Francis Xavier, and he's going now to take us through the calculations. How much money you need to have your own roof so that you own your own house. Renting is a prison itself.
Yes.
But now we are glad we have you. And we are going to start on our journey of freeing ourselves from this prison.
We talked about renting being a financial prison, how people get very comfortable with what's not theirs, only because it takes them in a certain bracket of expenses. Mm. So if they do their calculations, and these expenses are constant over time, they project with their salary or wages, and they get this kind of comfort that they stay in someone's property for years and years. Mm. You actually find 50, 60-year-old parents raising their kids, raising all their children to the point of graduating and getting married, but when they are renting, because they are very comfortable. But it has a limitation in one way or another in terms of, of course, accumulating a certain kind of wealth or doing other things, for example, to plan for the kids. Because, you know, in any country, not just here, as long as you plan for your kids, for your children, you lay a very good foundation for them.
For them, true.
Just like we need a good house foundation for the building to last
for a long time.
For a long time. Education these days isn't enough to be a foundation of the kids. So that means when you have your home, you reduce your expenses, you plan better for these kids and give them a better foundation. Education is a good foundation.
You know, even the Bible says it.
Yes.
That a good father is the one that leaves inheritance
for his children. Yes. So if you have a good foundation, education is the good foundation. But you can give them a better foundation by giving them education and something else.
And also a comfortable environment for them to live in.
For them to grow.
Remember, these kids are also, okay, this is what I've realized, that they are also stressed because they get to know of the baggage that their parents carry.
Yes.
And rent being number one in this case. They don't want to be embarrassed by being chased out or being knocked on their doors every other day.
Yes.
So in our previous episode, you had talked about inviting engineers from inception.
Yes.
So that they can take you through the BOQs and you plan well to get to understand how much money you'll be saving and for how long to have your own building.
Okay.
So I'm going to leave you like to, again, start from there.
Okay, from just your previous point, let me just take you back just a little bit. Where you talked about the kids being mentally disturbed by what they see. You know, the thing with renting is how it even affects children further is the constant movement. It's like educating a child, taking them to different schools. It affects them mentally. That's the same thing with renting and moving. One day, they have concrete relationships with certain people. Then by the time they come back from school, they are staying elsewhere because their rent was so high here.
God.
So that affects their growth. It affects their growth because people get confidence and everything else from the relationships you create while you're growing up.
And
it builds your confidence. Yeah. It builds your... It literally builds you as a person for you to grow in a place that is mentally good.
Have you realized, okay, for us when we are growing up, we are these people who would invite our friends to our homes.
Yes.
our fellow learners to our homes. Eh?
Yes.
But it is so embarrassing for one not to have a permanent home. Today Definitely. You're here. When they come, you're another place.
Yes. Of course, it's very, very disturbing for a child because...
You become a nomad.
Yeah, because look, if you go to a place, you've lost your friend. I won't say you've lost, but as a child, you've lost. Because I'm assuming a basic child won't have a phone.
Yeah.
So if you move, you're not going to have a means of communication to these old friends of yours. So you're constantly creating new friendships. Probably the friendships you've created already are a bit productive.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're shifting to another place. Never know, you might find toxic people. Or you can find those anywhere.
Yeah, change but, can be good, but change it can be still good. Be
It can
bad.
Also be bad. But how do you avoid overmoving? How do you avoid this rental problem of, you know, landlords chasing you around? Because the problem with rent is, first of all, it gets comfortable. Like we said, it's a financial prison. Mm. So the fact that it gets comfortable, that means you start taking it for granted.
Mm.
You take the rent for granted.
Yes.
So you say, ah, it's I'm paying 500,000. Exactly. You learn to live with it and know that that money is there. So it gives you this kind of comfort that it's only 500,000, I'm earning 1.5 million, I'll pay. But the moment you go in, say 5 months of arrears, that's already at 2.5 million, way above your salary.
Mm.
So how are you going to tackle that problem in the future? Yet now the arrears are more than your rental expense. So it becomes hard. During the last show, we talked about living. Rent.
Yes.
Trying to construct your own home.
Yes.
So today we want to give people an insight of how this can be done.
Exactly. Because you can, many things are easily talked about than being done.
Yes.
You know,
it's easier to talk.
Yeah, you can talk to someone and then they tell, I mean, you can feel like you can even tomorrow construct a huge like building like where we are.
Yes.
But now the practicability.
Yes. Now, the thing is, this all starts with a desire. The moment you don't have a desire, like we talked about in the last show, you're not going to construct. So, but desire is backed up by a plan.
Because
you have to have a plan.
You know what you are going to do?
Yes.
You give us hope that by a 30 by 50,
yes,
I can have a home,
yes,
comfortable home.
Yes.
Because honest living, when you see the places we rent in,
sometimes
they're
not that big.
They're not big, yes, actually. Where we pay to stay,
yes,
the places are not big. So by 30 and 40, I'm going to perhaps look for 30, 40 or 50 by 100 or 50 by 50.
Actually, I can put it this way for the viewers.
Mm.
You can rent a place, a house, that is in an area, okay, that is in a space of say 50 by 100, but it has 5 units. So you just try to divide those 5 units, and then you see how much unit can cost, and no, can take in terms of space. So that means if you have a 50 by 50, okay, let me go back to the one you suggested. If you go back to a 30 by 40, what is, we start looking at minimums. What is the minimum for a bedroom? It is about 3 by 3 meters. Mm. So 3 meters, now since the plot is in feet, let me try to convert the dimensions in feet so that the viewers understand. So if you have a 30 by 40, the minimum of a room is 3 by 3 feet. That means you have...
you can have a bed.
A bedroom, which is, which if it's 3 by 3,
yes,
in terms of feet, it's 9 by 9, because one meter is 3 feet. So that means you can have 3 feet by three, which is 9 meters by nine.
By 9 meters.
No, so by 9 feet by nine. Nine. Yes.
So that means in that room.
Yes.
That specific room.
Yes.
I can have a bed.
Yes.
I can have a wardrobe.
Yes.
I can have a dressing room.
I can actually go on to break down how this works.
Please help us.
The standard bed that people like, okay, of course, apart from the 6x6, now that's a double, big double
that's
bed.
High end.
Yes, but say, okay, the maximum size on aside is 6 feet, because you can get a 4x6, mm-hmm. a 6x5, a 6x6, mm-hmm. a 6x3, even a 6x3.5. So that means you have a maximum length of 6 meters. So if you have a room of 9 feet and you put your bed of 6 feet, mm-hmm. you have a balance of 3 feet. But remember, it's taking 6 feet on one side, but taking 3 or 4 or 5 on the other side. So that means the wardrobe, the minimum length for wardrobe is 0.6 meters, which is 2 feet. Mm. So if you reduce the 2 feet on now the other side, because you can't put the wardrobe next to the bed, so it's on the other empty side. Mm. So you also remove your wardrobe of 2 feet. And of course, now the length, its length is up to you. If you want a double, if you want a single, that all depends on how you want to utilize your space. So that means you're going to have your bed, you're going to have your wardrobe, and now you're going to have your dressing mirror, a small table inside, everything is going to fit, and some remaining space for you to maneuver around your bedroom. Yes. But after doing all this, that room remains at 9 feet. A 9x9, that means you deduct 9 from each side. Mm-hmm. Now, if you have on the 40 feet side, yes, from the 40 feet side, you've reduced 9, so your balance is 31 feet. So from your 30, you deduct 9, your balance is 21. No, for the same bedroom, you're deducting 40 on one, from 40 on one side, you're deducting from 30 on another side. That means you have a balance of 31 against 21. Mm. So now, we are now putting a sitting room. So you can decide now how you orient it. It all depends on you. Mm. But personally, I would prefer this house goes in length of the 30 feet side, so that the 40 feet elongates to get you a well-organized and spacious compound. Mm. Not very spacious, but enough.
Wait a minute.
Yes.
On the 30x40,
yes,
I can still get a compound.
You can, and this is what I'm trying to explain.
This is what you
that mean. That when you get your nine feet reduced, that means on the 20, because now I've suggested that we put it along the 30 feet length.
Side.
Yes. So if you remove the 9 feet, you remain with 21. Mm. A sitting room, you can even increase it. It can be over 9 feet. Because I mean, you need chairs, you need extra things. Yes, you need enough space. So you can even put it at say 15. So if you add 15 plus 9, you're still at 24. You still have a balance of 6. So you can leave 2 on either side. And then you can leave 3 on either side to make your 30. So are you seeing that you've put your bedroom, you've put your sitting room? Now, the fact that the sitting room is bigger, of course, now how you elongate it this side is what is going to give you the extra spaces, for example, for the kitchen and for the small store. So, and also for the store, you can put it on the veranda of the sitting
the
room.
The sitting room.
Yes, it can be there. That I think that is a functional home.
It is.
Now, in all that, you've only moved this side 9, plus maybe the toilet, which is about 5 feet. So when you add 9 and 5, that is 14. So you have 14 on the 40 feet side.
14 on the 40 feet, so it means I have 36 remaining?
Yes, no, you have 26 remaining on that side. Yes, so if you have 26 remaining, that compound is enough. Because the cars you see, yes, because if you have a balance of 26, like from the house to your perimeter, meanwhile, you can still have your fence of the perimeter wall. So, because this one is taking the boundaries. So, if you go on your boundaries and you construct your perimeter wall around your boundary of the 30 and 40, you're still going to have a space of, say, 25 from your house to the end of the perimeter wall. So, that means on one side of that fence, because now you have 25 here, but here, it will be longer than that. It will take the 40 stretch because that entire space is empty. So you have 30 free and you have 25. So if you have a compound of 25x30, I mean, you can do anything with it.
Yes.
You can demarcate a portion and you put some green because you cannot have a house that's very boring. Mm. Yes, you have to put something that will bring fresh air. Of course, you know the science behind plantations and human life. So you have to put some plants, you have to put some green, and also the scenery is just better. Then on one end, you put your pavers where you can park your car if you have one, or even two cars. Two cars can actually fit in that property. So are you saying it might be squeezed, but it will fit?
Yes.
So when you're going back, you're actually going back to your home. Actually, you imagine that.
It can be squeezed, yes. But it is your home. Because while you're renting,
it's not
squeezed.
Your home. Yes.
It's not your home. You're paying, but you're
and you're still squeezed and uncomfortable. Because the difference between your own home and where you're renting, first of all, you're watching. Who's seeing me? You're watching out for people. You're scared of doing what you really want to do. You can't actually sit
There's
outside
no
the compound. There's no privacy generally. You can't have, if say your child has a birthday party, you can't just have it there. You have to go spend. You have to go and spend maybe at a restaurant, because if you're to be it outside,
you're inconveniencing
others, or you have to invite them and they join you. So all that attributes to more expenses. When you go to a restaurant, more expenses. When you put it around and you invite your neighbors, more expenses. Because I mean, it will be very mean of someone to put something outside there
with a neighbor,
and your neighbors are just watching.
I know.
Yeah, so all those are expenses that are attributed to renting. So if you have your 30 by 40, I've described how you can plan for it. Now, if you have more, you know, the minimum requirement, I think by our authorities, is 50 by 100 for you to have a title. Now, if you have less than that, does it mean you cannot construct? No, you can. I've just told you can construct only 30 by 40.
Yes.
And what if you have 50 by 50? That is
so
even
it means
good
you can
enough.
Have page, like,
a spacious
more,
home.
You can even have more rooms.
Yes, you can have more rooms. You can actually have a two-bedroomed house.
Even have a
or even a three-bedroomed. You can have a more spacious garden. You can have more parking. It will still not be as spacious as someone who has a 50 by 100 or 100 by 100, but that is good enough. Now, you might, a viewer might question themselves that if you have a 50 by 100, if you have those small spaces, can you construct a storage building? Can you construct a flat?
Now, that is exactly what I wanted to ask you.
Yes.
Are we limited with our small spaces in what we should construct?
We are not limited, because the smaller the space, as long as you're planning to construct something storied, the better. Why? Because that means you're going to have less less congestion down. Yes,
so you can push
like
it
the
up.
Building area down will be less, and you push it up. So that means instead of you having three bedrooms down, and they take up all that space that you could have used for other things. The compound are very nice. You know, these days we construct gazebos for clients.
Yeah.
A very nice gazebo.
We even want laundry rooms.
Laundry rooms, outside kitchen.
Yes.
So instead of having all that within one space, you reduce the building area and make it storied. You find that down, you have the essentials, which is maybe one bedroom, a sitting room, of course some toilet for the visitors, probably a kitchen. And then you go up and you put like two extra or three extra bedrooms, but the space will be less. The building area, the built up area down will be less. So which means that you can now go up and put more rooms. You have more space. That means you have a bigger compound. That means you can do many things from your compound.
Engineer, I just want to get it right from you.
Yes.
Is it like a decorum for engineers that if one is planning on having a storied building, then they reduce on the area beneath, like, I don't know, the construction area.
The moment
to be less compared to,
of course,
what
now
is going to be up
for someone to have a storied building, that means they want a big house, but not utilize all that space. Because you imagine you have a five bedroom home. You'll put probably one room or two rooms down, then sitting room, dining, kitchen, store, and everything else, laundry area. And then you take the three bedrooms or four bedrooms up. But you imagine you put all that on ground. So you have to expand the house. Mm. Of course, now for its beauty, you have to divide those rooms accordingly. Maybe you put a sitting room here with two rooms, and then on the other wing, you put extra rooms. Mm. But you're taking up a lot of space. So a person, of course, half storied is more expensive. Mm. If you can afford it, it's better for planning purposes of your space. But in case you can't, yes.
Because you are helping us envision our transition from the financial prison of renting,
yes,
to our freedom of owning our own places, eh? My own thinking, meaning if I have my car 50 by 50 feet,
yes,
I can still plan to have a double story building.
Yes, you can
eventually, like, it helps me either way.
Yes,
and when God blesses me, I can perhaps get a, like, an acre, eh?
Somewhere, yes.
Maybe a country home, and this can be rented out or given to the kids that are...
To another person who wants to rent.
Another person, right? So I think they are not exonerated still by saying the space is small.
There is no space that's small when it's your own home. Mm. Because the bigger space that you're comparing to, first of all, is used communally. It's used by many people. So if I have a big compound, say it stretches 100 meters here, but it's not yours, because however much you pay 1 million for this apartment, they are going to give you one parking spot. Yes, they are giving you one parking spot, or at most two.
One?
Yes, at most two.
Okay, at most
two. Yes, but most of the time, they are giving you one parking spot. So if they are giving you one parking spot, how is that big space? It's only big because of your vision. You're visualizing it to be big. You're looking at it as a big space.
It is actually, but it's big actually for not the very owner. Big.
It's yes,
big for the owner.
It's big for
but
the
for
owner.
You, but you are used. That.
Exactly. You just walk. If you live upstairs, you walk all the way. The stairs are communal. If you found someone and they are stuck there with, say, chairs, they are trying to carry them to their house,
you
have to wait for them. Yes, you have to wait for them to go. So that is actually smaller. So you cannot say there is any small piece of land.
Yeah.
Because however small, you can develop something that is a home for you. Like we said, however beautiful, it's never yours. Mm. Unless you own it, it will be beautiful. So if you have your 50 by 50, and you want, say, a three-bedroom house, it can fit. Because these houses, say, your family is growing big.
Mm.
If you get a fortune later, if you get blessed by the Lord, and probably you earn more money, or you do something that gets you more money,
well and good,
you can now construct elsewhere. But even within that same plot, because people play, like I said, people play it safe a lot. They play it as if because they fear. They have this fear. But like you said, success is on the other end of fear. So the moment you fear, you will not do what's yours. You will not own anything. So this calls for all viewers to start planning. The moment you plan, you cannot fail. Because even if you visualize to stay, even if you have a dream of staying in a storied house, you can still achieve it by starting with your bungalow. Later on, we can upgrade that bungalow to a flat. We can. And if you have an initial plan and you're very ambitious and you don't have that fear like most people do, we actually start your plan as a storied building. We finish the ground floor, we cast the slab, and then you stay there. That's what most people actually do. You continue up your roof.
Brilliant.
And then and then you do the finishes.
Brilliant.
So how is it hard, yet you've started and you're planning for the future? Because the moment you don't do that, you will never do it. And money for construction in our economy here, it is very hard to get. Of course, it all depends on where you work and your source of income. But it's usually not, I'm speaking on behalf of the people, the majority of the population. It's very hard to get 300, 500 million at once and you say, I'm going to construct my flat.
True.
So that is why people construct in phases.
This is the Homes and Construction Show. And what we told you, we aim at changing people's lives. Today, we have had Engineer Francis Xavier. and he has broken down how you can plan to transition from renting to owning your home. Remember, renting is a financial prison. This has been the Homes and Construction Affairs Show. My name is Hilda Kamkama. But from me and my entire crew, we want to say thank you very much and may God bless you.